for those who are politically wise, a show about the lives of Christians in Ohio involved with politics. Introducing your host, Reverend Thomas Wise.
Greetings, my fellow patriots, saints, and sinners. The show is titled Politically Wise, and I am your host, Reverend Thomas Wise. At the end of the show, there will be a blessing. Don't miss it. But first, a word from our sponsor. Do you pray for a politician? Do you think a politician can be a Christian? Do you think a politician should stand up for Christian principles? Do you think politicians should pray together? Do you want to see more Christians in politics? If you said yes to any of these questions, please join the Ohio Prayer Caucus Network. Find the Ohio Prayer Caucus Network on Facebook. Welcome back to Politically Wise. The opinions and statements on this show belong to those who give them. The rest of the show belongs to Thomas Wise Words, all rights reserved. The show is titled Politically Wise, and I am your host, Reverend Thomas Wise. Hello, my listeners. This is Reverend Thomas Wise. The show is called Politically Wise. I have a new guest today. Jeff, would you introduce yourself to my listeners?
I sure will, and thanks for having me. My name is Jeff Rezabek, and I'm a candidate for the 43rd District. That district involves basically Northwest Montgomery County as well as all of Preble County. And I'm a resident of Clayton. Graduated from the University of Dayton twice, undergrad and as well as law school. I'm a practicing attorney. I have my own office in the city of Dayton. And most of that work is working with juvenile court, where I assist families and help them through the system, and also represent children in court and act in their best interest to make sure that they're protected and that they're safe. Part of my other work is just basically a general practice.
So did you grow up here in Clayton?
I did not. I'm originally from Western New York, a small town by the name of Grand Island, basically between Buffalo and Niagara Falls. Growing up there with my parents, was born and raised in Buffalo, but then chose to come to Dayton, basically come to the University of Dayton, the Marinus Institution, and continued my education there.
Did you grow up Catholic?
Yes, I did.
And you currently are practicing Catholic?
Yes, I am.
It's okay. I'm a practicing Christian. One day I hope to get this right. before I graduate, right?
That's right.
Why did you go into law?
Well, early on, and this is it's kind of a funny story. Way back in fifth grade, we had a great teacher that basically had a class, or a part of our class was creating a small community. And I chose to be the lawyer in that community, and it was basically to assist people and help people. And that kind of continued. I actually went to the University of Dayton in my undergrad as a psychology major. I did a lot of history as well in that. But when I came back to the university to go to, I started my master's program in psychology. But my professor, one of the professors there, said, you've always been interested in law and you want to do that. And so I ended up in law school. And when I graduated, I actually went back to New York for a short period of time to pass the New York bar, came to Ohio when I was offered a job, and I really found my calling in the law, where I'm helping and assisting people, and actually helping people who can't afford a good lawyer, or people who are being, that don't know how to work, go through the system. And that service, as I ran in 2012, I ran for juvenile court judge at that point. We did not win the race, but that doesn't mean we weren't successful, because the successful campaign, and what I tried to do was stay positive in that campaign, and what we wanted to do was change the community to provide a better court and a better system. And the judge that did win has taken many of our ideas and then run with that. So it was a successful campaign. But getting back a little bit, my dad in the 2012 race did a little talk to some people, and he actually chronicled how I've always helped people and always did a service for the less fortunate than myself and my family. And dad really characterized that's what I'm always there trying to help people get themselves standing up. And I think it all really began, to be honest with you, during my confirmation year, that we had to do a service project, and I worked with the Special Olympics. And again, it was both, you do it as a one-year program, and that I continued with Special Olympics all the way through my undergrad time frame, helping those athletes out, and it just kind of continued and went on from there.
So what boards or charities you work with now?
Oh, in the past, we've worked with, the best one that I've worked with is Irma's House with Catholic Social Services. Irma's House was a program that was kind of connected with juvenile court. It provides families that need assistance either in supervised visitation or that they need a place to exchange the child so that the parents act appropriately and the kids feel safe. We work with Catholic Social Services to do a number of fundraising to actually get them a building, and it's now the Catholic Social Services building / Irma's house right by the University of Dayton. I also am on the board of a company called Choices. Choices is a foster care company that really focuses on, and one of our missions is really looking at providing a need for the community of children that are in foster care that are, I would say, the general focus is between 10 and 17, and those that are 18, we do an independent living program with them, and that's a great, great company there on that board, as well as I work with Action, Inc. Action is an adoption agency that does a wonderful job. They're actually changing up some of the things they do because they're joining with another company because of some regulations and all that. It just becomes too much of a burden for many of these great small companies to continue their good work, so they kind of join together. So I know that's happening. And I've, of course, stayed in connection with the University of Dayton. I've been on the local chapter board as well as the National Alumni Board chapter to do many of the good works that the university not only does in the city of Dayton, but all around. We have chapters all around the country and work with those chapters or those organizations to continue the university's motto of learn, lead, and serve. And again, in the alumni chapters, we really focus on the service aspect of the university.
So you're running for state representative. The good news is that you're going to be my state representative.
Well, good.
God's
then
grace.
I can get a plug in here that I would ask for your consideration and vote in November, right?
That's right. That's right. While we're at it, do you have a website
yes,
for that
we do.
Campaign?
Yes, we do. It is voterezabek.com, and it's VoteRezabek, if you don't know how to spell my last name. Voterezabek.com.
So why do you want the job? Why do you want to be state representative?
Well, and I had moved into Clayton a number of years ago, and one of the things that had happened is the 4970 corridor up there on Salem and that. That neighborhood and that area has just been constantly over the years not been doing well. And what happened was, and when you heard the talk around the town, is no one really knew who their state representative was at that point, or at least in the last year when I've been looking at this race. And we don't have an advocate in Columbus. And that's what I thought we needed, the 43rd District. We needed somebody to go to Columbus and advocate for the issues that are happening in the 43rd. And part of it was an economic standpoint, because if you notice, there are the state of Ohio has begun that economic surge and that's happening around the state. And it's actually happening around our region in the Miami Valley. You have companies coming in this in Moraine. You have companies coming up in Miami County, northern Montgomery County. But what seemed to be happening is that none of that, all that good stuff that was happening around the state and happening locally, was avoiding the 43rd District. And I believed as an advocate, one of the things I do in juvenile court in that advocacy is you work with people who are not working well together, and you get them working to a common goal to reach a positive solution. And I think I can take that and hopefully get to Columbus and make sure that, one, that we're getting an advocate, a strong advocate for our 43rd District and all the families in our 43rd District, but more importantly, that we can start seeking some of the benefits that are happening around the state and is happening in our area and bring it to the 43rd. The 43rd District is a great district. We actually mirror the state of Ohio. We are rural, we are urban, and we are suburban, and it's ready to explode, but we need an advocate to get us over that edge, and I think I can do that.
How does the district look? What's good going on in the district, and what's not so good? What are the areas that need work?
The areas that, and let me start with the bad news first, kind of the areas that need work. I just mentioned some of that is the economics and the housing issues, especially in the Trotwood area and on Salem, that, you know, because we don't have those good paying jobs and we don't have any business expansion in that area, we're hurting the housing and the homes and the individuals, which that in turn hurts property values, which then drives down funds for our schools, and we've got to change that trend around. I mean, there have been people in office for a long time that haven't been, they keep saying they're going to do it. We need somebody of action, and I believe that I am of action. We have had some great successes in some small parts up in Lewisburg. We did have some expansion at a facility called Pratt, and they're doing wonderful things. We need to continue, and especially out in western Montgomery County, as well as all of Preble County, we need to continue to work with the farmers and making sure they're protected, making sure they're not being overregulated. That's one of the things. We had a great, we were at a candidate night in a wonderful little church out in Camden, and we had this very young man, he's 16 years old, great Christian home. He comes up to me and he asks me about, why do I need the state regulator to come to my house to ask about the eggs that I'm selling, and I have to pay him money, and then I have to do the same thing for a county person. And that's a great question, and it's a one that I've been talking about all along, is that we need to consolidate those services so that he can continue to do his small business, and that he continue to make sure he's a strong business owner, and that he can reach out and we can consolidate those services so you don't have to repeat it and save money for everybody.
Come the end of December, by God's grace, you've won the election. You go in and speaker's office, and the speaker says, congratulations on winning your seat. Now, what can you do for us? Now, understand, we got all the lawyers we want. What kind of things would you like to sit on? What kind of boards would you like to sit on, or committees you'd like to sit on?
Okay. The Ohio Natural Resources and Ag Committee would be the first one we'd look at sitting on, simply because that's a huge part of our district, and we want to make sure we have a strong advocate in that area. I've been meeting with the Farm Bureau, both in Montgomery and Preble County, which is real important. And one of the things, I keep answering the question, but I want to just take it aside. One of the things that I did that was important in this campaign is I've gone out and listened to the community. Starting this campaign, if you had asked me some ag questions and all that, I don't think I could have answered them. But with the welcoming of the farmers in western Montgomery County as well as in Preble County, we've learned. And one of the things that I want to take to the State House is that I'm not going to have the best answers to every question. I need to reach out back to the community, back to, if it's a specific issue, or back to my church, or back to all the different players that are out there, and ask for their guidance, because that's what a good representative does, not just so they make a decision based on what I think is right. Let's look at the district, and let's look at what we need to do in a positive direction. The other area, of course, that I would look at and being on is in the educational committee, simply because I believe that's a strong area that we need to continue to work on. We need to make sure our kids are ready to meet the goals of the 21st century, make sure that they are well-equipped also to, well-equipped to meet the needs of any of the jobs that are coming into the area, and make sure that workforce is ready, and so that we can demonstrate. Because if you have a ready workforce that's going to tackle the employment and the jobs that are out there, then you can get those companies moving into your area. And as you have said, that as a lawyer, I probably would like to be on the Judiciary Committee. And part of that is, one, to do two things. One, to look at simplifying the law. This past year, I had an opportunity with the local judge in a difficult case to look at what was written. And this judge, who I consider probably one of the most intelligent persons I've known, was asking me, and neither of us could make sense. So I want to make sure that the laws actually read as they're supposed to. And then also, one of the things is, when you're looking at these laws, want to make sure that we don't have any unintended consequences down the road. I mean, we're not supposed to be up there justifying our position by making bad law. Let's look at what the issues are. Let's make a good decision, make sure we understand the consequences in the future of that law, and make sure we address the needs of the community. And there are a limited amount of attorneys up in the state house. There's not too many of us left up there.
By God's grace.
Yes, sir.
So how does your faith play a role in wanting to become a elected official?
Well, again, when you go for a political position or any type of role in stepping up and becoming a leader, that's one of the first places you go back to and ask, is, should I be doing this? And you, with your family and your church, you look at, get some guidance. And that's really the faith. When I look back, when I ask myself and talk to people, that's the guidance that I look for, is, are we doing the right thing for myself? Are we doing the right thing for my family? Is the right thing for my faith? And promote it, what we would like to see change in the community. And that doesn't mean we're, stepping on anybody's toes, but that we would like to make sure this country is founded, in a Christian way. And I think we should continuously still use that motto and move forward with it. We want to make sure that everything, when we make a decision to do something, that we take that, and again, as I said earlier, take that extra step and look back to make sure we're doing right for everybody in the district.
Do you have a guiding scripture?
I do not. I know that was the potential question and all that. I do not.
And that's okay. Not very,
It's funny, is because there are a number of songs that come to mind that I turn to more than not, as if I'm having a bad day, or even a good day. Some days, when we have a good day, especially in juvenile court or something, you want to give thanks because of the lives that we're affecting, and we want to make sure things go forward.
What's a bad day look like for you?
A bad day for me is one that, if and I'll talk from work standpoint, a bad day is one where if we've gone to court and tried to help a family, or I've tried to help someone in the office, and we weren't able to get the outcome, and we weren't able to, and especially in a juvenile case, we weren't able to get what a lot of us talk about is permanency for the child. When we're in juvenile court, that's really what we're trying to do, is make sure we have a great stability, and we have a good plan for a family and a child to make sure that they can have a good life. And there are days, and the bad days are in a sense of where we haven't come to that conclusion yet, and we have to continue it. And it's just putting a family or a child in a state of unknowingness, and you just try to, I'd like to get that resolved and move it forward. Versus, a good day is when, a couple weeks ago, we had a great day in juvenile court. I'd worked with a family and a mother who a couple of years ago, when she came in, I represented her, and we got her linked up with, I didn't know what church she went to and all that. We got her aunt said she would start taking her to church. She started going to church, and, a year into the process, she was making good progress, but was not, we didn't think the child would be able to be returned. And over the last, little more than a year from then, she got involved more with her church, or more with her aunt's church, and now it's her church, and she did a tremendous amount of change personally, and we had a great day in court because she came in, her child, and we had already been expecting this because the child had been going home basically on almost on a permanent basis, but we got to have that day in court, and the exciting thing is you get to have a mom and a child, and they get to come in, and you get to see the magistrate who's either been frustrated or worked hard on this case, all the attorneys, the guardian ad litem in the case, and Children's Services. And, it's a great day when the two attorneys who had been fighting, Children's Services, the guardian ad litem, the child and the mother walk out of the court hand in hand. That's a good day.
So this is your second run for political office.
Yes.
What advice would you have for someone who wants to run for political office?
Oh, wow. We could spend an hour on that. The real thing is, make sure you're doing it for the right reason. Make sure you're not just doing it just to try and get a political seat or trying to just make a change or something. You really have to look at it and see what you want to do and why you want to do it. And then you have that passion for that job. Because as I look at it, and this is, I always try and tell people, I'm not really a politician because I sometimes will speak my mind, and I hope I continue to do that. But you got to remember when you're in this position or you're going to be looking to seek this, that you're going to have an opportunity to make a difference and make a positive change in your community. And once you've made that positive change in your community, you should have a plan of what the next project in that job is, and not just go in there with one thought and one idea, because you're supposed to be helping everybody in that community, and you should continuously work hard for that. And if you've accomplished everything that you needed to do, then go back to your regular job. Early in our country's history, there was not a job of being a politician, and I kind of believe in that. I think it's a calling for service. And I think if you have that calling, you go, you complete your job, you complete that service, and then you come back to your community and you continue on with what you previously were doing. And I think you can continuously do that. And I think you can be called back to service when it's needed, or you have a wonderful idea that it will be a positive impact on the community and in your area, and whatever area it is. Whether it's just from sitting on a city council to a township to the school board, or becoming a judge, or if it happens to be in the higher, as you go up to the state politics or governor, even a congressman, senator, or even the president, you got to have a plan and you got to have a passion for continuously helping people. And if you lose your way, then you're going to be doing more harm. And I would ask you, those politicians that have been in for a long time to look at why they're there and why they're still there. Are they still following that passion? Are they still following that calling? Continue to strive for that.
Has someone been a mentor for you?
Well, there's probably been probably several from my father and that, but the more... in the law practice and in this journey that I've taken since I've become an attorney, there was a gentleman by the name of Charles Smiley, who was my first boss, but he was more than a boss. He would help you along the way and point out things in such a kind and refreshing manner that he, and just one, there's two quick stories about him. I had been in a criminal case and where we did extremely well, and I was grilling a witness very hard and all that, and was making points, and that's why we won the case. But he was so Mr. Smiley was so kind that we walked back to the office, and in one block, I asked him how he thought I did, and he said he did good, but wouldn't have been asking just these four questions. Wouldn't have that been better? And the sense was, yeah, those questions were absolutely better. But what it did is it made the system better, and it made my client believe that the system worked. It made the prosecutor and the witness believe that the system worked. And it was, you didn't get to have the fun of grilling the witness, but it would have been much more effective to making sure everything went well in court. And Mr. Smiley, he was the kind of guy that made sure everything, that everybody was well protected and everybody was well served. And that's, one of the things that I miss about him, is that he was able to help you, work with you and improve your life in that. And you know, he had the weekend before he passed. He was so proud of himself. He got to be one of the wise men. He went to the Christian Life Center, and that's where his family went to church. And he got to be one of the wise men at their play, and going to watch him at that play and all that. He just made him, you know, he was just all proud of the small act that he played. And it was kind of fitting because that's how I saw him. He was always that wise gentleman that always helped you and never criticized you, but always corrected you and, you know, did it in a positive way to help you along. And if I could do, you know, a tenth of what he did to help somebody else, I would like to do that.
Well, sir, we've been talking for quite a while now. Is there anything that you wanted to bring up in this interview? Any other issues that I have not thought to ask you about?
No, I think we hit on all the areas that I know we wanted to talk about. And I just, you know, would like to have the opportunity to reach out to your listeners and that, the opportunity to demonstrate what I can do in Columbus and be a strong advocate for the 43rd District.
And give us your website again.
Again, it's voterezabek.com.
All right, sir. One final thing. Any particular way we can pray for you?
The biggest thing that I would ask is, and again, if we get, through this process to make sure that not only myself, is that all the individuals that have chosen to run, that they're safe and their families are safe. But in particular for me is that if I am elected, to make sure that your listeners would pray that I would, get guidance and make sure we had clarity to resolve many of the issues that are facing the 43rd District and that are facing the families of the state of Ohio and, you know, around the country. Because if we can generate some good things in Ohio, hopefully with prayer we can spread that around to the rest of the country.
All right, sir. Thank you again for this interview.
Thank you so much for your time, and I appreciate it.
This is Reverend Thomas Wise, and the show is called Politically Wise.
Partnership with Liberty Prayer Network. Hi, I'm Matt Staver, founder and chairman of Liberty Council. We'll talk about this next on Freedom's Call. An intercessory prayer ministry has now officially merged with Liberty Council and brought to life the Liberty Prayer Network. Through prayer, we will intercede for the United States, biblically based public policy, and champions of life, liberty, and the family. While praying for our nation, we remain committed to standing with Israel and partnering with those from other nations who uphold religious freedom, the sanctity of human life, and the family. We are enlisting prayer patriots to take a stand in their home states, lifting high the torch of liberty and calling others to worship God and to pray for his blessings. If you would like to join the Liberty Prayer Network, call us today at 1-800-671-1776. That's 800-671-1776. Or visit our website at lc.org.
The show is titled Politically Wise, and I am your host, Reverend Thomas Wise.
If we ever forget that we're one nation under God, then we will be a nation gone under.
Join us and publicly display this model.
In God we trust. Go to ingodwetrust.com today. Order your decal and display it proudly.
Let's again write In God We Trust on our buildings, in our classrooms, to combat the anti-God dismantling of our nation.
Say it and display it. In God We Trust. Go to ingodwetrust.com.
The show is titled Politically Wise, and I am your host, Reverend Thomas Wise. Thank you for listening today. If you want to email me, you may do so at politically.wise@gmail.com. Please like us on our Facebook page, Politically Wise. Now, here's your blessing. Blessings based on Psalms chapter 22, verses 20 through 31. Do you fear the Lord? Do you praise Him? God has not hidden His face from you. God does listen to your cries. God loves it when you fulfill your vows. Seek the Lord and praise Him. Remember the Lord and bow down to Him. proclaim the Lord's righteousness every day.